Hi everyone, welcome to the second lecture of Design of Reinforced Concrete Structure. In this lecture, we will learn some other basic concepts, and these concepts are very important and necessary for civil engineers. In the previous lecture, I have explained you the basic properties of concrete and steel. We will use these properties here in second lecture. So let's take a look what we are going to cover in this video lecture. There are two parts of this video lecture. The first part is introduction to load, the loads that apply on a structure. So here we will learn about dead load, live load, also known as imposed load, and environmental load. Here we will have a brief introduction to these loads and later study them in detail. Please note that understanding these loads is really important to improve your design skills. After that, the second and important part of this lecture is on design philosophy. Second part of the lecture has four sections. The first section is about philosophy that developed over the year to analyze and design the reinforced cement structure. Then we will learn about three design philosophies, working stress method, then ultimate load method, and at last, limit state method. So let's begin here with introduction of load. Do you remember the process of designing from first lecture? We have learned about analysis and design process in previous lecture. After selecting the most appropriate structural system, the most important and most difficult task faced by a structural designer is the accurate estimation of load. And after the loads are estimated, the next problem is to decide the worst possible combination of these loads. For example, if you are designing a highway bridge which is covered with ice and snow, and at the same time heavily loaded trucks are running in every lane, and 100 km per hour lateral wind is acting on the bridge. So if all these loads are acting at the same time, we have to prepare a worst possible combination of these loads to design the structure. Now let's take a look on classification of loads. Loads are classified in three categories: dead load, imposed or live load, environmental load. Let us understand each one by one. Dead loads are loads of constant magnitude that remain in one position. One position means a fixed position. Dead loads include the weight of structure as well as the weight of other parts that are permanently attached to structure. For a reinforced concrete building, some dead loads are loads of frame structure, I mean load of beam and column, load of wall, load of slab, load of stairways. In short, whatever attached permanently to the structure is known as dead load. On the other hand, live loads are loads that can change in magnitude and position. Some types of live loads are loads of people, furniture and storage items. Traffic load for bridge. Here all the vehicles are moving and they are considered as a live load to a structure. Impact load. Impact load imposed on a structure due to vibration of moving or movable load. Sometimes you have noticed a lot of vibration when a heavy loaded truck passes on a highway. We call this vibration an impact load, and which is also considered as live load. Another one is longitudinal loads. Stopping train on a bridge or a truck on a highway bridge causes longitudinal load. When fast moving truck takes suddenly brakes, it's called longitudinal load. Some other types of loads are soil pressure on walls or foundation, hydrostatic pressure of water on dams, etc. An important thing is that all these loads directly or indirectly depend on gravity. Environmental loads are loads caused by environment in which structure is located. The environmental loads are also live load, but they are due to environment. The main difference between live load and environmental load is that all the live loads are due to gravity, but all the environmental loads are not due to gravity. For example, earthquake load, which does not depend on gravity. Some of the environmental loads depend on gravity, but not all of them. The few types of environmental loads are snow and ice, rain, wind, seismic and earthquake loads. After having a general overview of reinforced concrete structure and understanding the basics of material and loads, it is time to learn actual process of designing. So now let us move to another part of the lecture, that is the design philosophy. I have already told you that there are four parts in this section. Let's start with what is design philosophy. The design philosophy of structure may be regarded as the process of selecting proper material and proportioning the elements of structure according to the art, engineering science, and technology. Design philosophy consists of two main factors. The fundamental assumption, here we assume some condition and ideal behavior of material and load. And second factor is procedure, or we can say it's a reflective way of thinking. After assumption, we develop a procedure to solve design problem. So let's take a look. How did these three philosophies evolve over the year in different parts of the world? The first one is working stress method. This method evolved in early 20th century, then ultimate load method. This method first introduced in USA in 1956 and in UK in 1957 and later on in India. Third is the limit state method. This method was developed in 1955, introduced in India in 1978 and completely implemented in IS 456 in 2000. IS 456 is completely based on limit state method. Let's study each of them in more detail. The first one is working stress method. This is a traditional method and you can also use it for steel and timber. The main assumption of this method are, it is assumed that structural members behave in linear elastic manner, and permissible or also known as allowable stress are kept well below the material strength. In this design method, members are designed to never go beyond their elastic range. The allowable stress is determined by suitably restricting the material yield or ultimate strength. The formula for allowable stress is yield or ultimate strength upon factor of safety. For ductile materials like steel, we use yield strength in formula as a reference to find the allowable stress. And for brittle materials like concrete, we use ultimate stress as a reference to find out the allowable stress. Factor safety for working stress method in IS 456 for concrete is 3 and for steel is 1.78. So how do we use this factor of safety to find the allowable stress? This is a stress strain curve of HYFG bar, and we can find out the yield stress using the concept of 0.2% proof strain. Let us assume its yield stress is 500 MPa. To find out allowable stress, we have to divide this yield stress with factor of safety of 1.78. And the value 280 MPa is allowable stress for design purpose. Let's take a look at another important concept of working stress method. When we apply load, stresses are induced in material and we can calculate them using the principle of strength of material. But reinforced cement concrete is a composite material. It has two different materials, concrete and steel. So here we cannot apply this principle directly. To apply the principle of strength of material, we use concept of strain compatibility. According to strain compatibility, there exists a perfect bond between the concrete and steel. It simply means that the strain developed in steel and surrounding concrete at any load are equal. Strain are equal for both materials. Stresses in steel are indirectly related to the stresses in surrounding concrete. This indirect relation between concrete and steel is expressed in terms of modular ratio. This is a very important concept for working stress method. So we can say here that modular ratio is the ratio of stresses in steel to stresses in concrete. We know according to Hooke's law that stresses is directly proportional to strain. Using modulus of elasticity, we can explore the formula. Strain in steel into modulus of elasticity of steel upon strain in concrete into modulus of elasticity of concrete. But due to strain compatibility, strain in steel is equal to strain in concrete, and modular ratio is ES over EC. Here comes another definition of modular ratio. It is ratio of two moduli of elasticity. This concept of modular ratio is backbone for working stress method, and that's why this method also known as modular ratio method. We will use concept of modular ratio in upcoming lecture for design purpose. But this method is no longer in practice except for a few design problems, because there are some drawbacks of working stress method. The actual stress distribution of concrete is not described. It is assumed to be elastic, but in reality, concrete is not elastic. If you remember from first lecture, modulus of elasticity of concrete, where I explained you that concrete is not only non-elastic, it's also non-linear. Another drawback are same factor safety used for different types of load. The failure mode cannot be observed. The warning before failure cannot be studied precisely. We cannot account shrinkage and creep effectively by using working stress method. So due to a lot of drawbacks, this method is fast disappearing from practice. IS code also recommends that working stress method may be used only if it is not possible to adopt the limit stress design. So you can use it if limit stress design is not possible to use. Next method is ultimate load method. This method was developed to overcome the shortcomings of working stress method. The assumption of this method are: it considers the non-linear behavior of concrete. It says that distribution of compressive stress is non-linear. The main fundamental assumption of this concept is: increase the working load by a suitable factor to obtain the ultimate load. The factor we use to find the ultimate load is known as load factor. Ultimate load is equal to working load into load factor. That's why this method is also known as load factor method. This method also no longer in practice. There are some drawbacks of this method. However, this method considers the nonlinear behavior of concrete, but there is no way to find the uncertainty in the variation in material strength. Because this method only considers the load factor, hence you cannot find out the behavior of materials under different types of load. Because of uncertainty in variation in material strength, you cannot also control the excessive deflection in structural element. So because of these types of drawbacks, this method also is not in practice. Now let us move to last and very important topic of this lecture, limit stress method. This section has two parts. In the first part, you will learn what is limit stress design, and in second part, there are some recommendations from IS 456 for limit stress design. In the second section, you will learn about characteristic strength and load, then the value of partial safety factors according to IS code, then design stress strength curve for concrete and reinforced steel. So let's get started. What is limit stress design? This method is advancement over traditional design methods like working stress method or load factor method. It is a plastic design method. We call it plastic design method because in this method, we assume that materials go beyond its yield strength. Material go to plastic range from elastic range. This method gives most comprehensive and rational solution to design problem. This method considers both strength and load equally, unlike working stress method, which is based on calculation of working stress of material alone, or unlike ultimate load method, which is completely based on calculation of ultimate load alone. So the main concept of this method is: consider the safety at ultimate load and serviceability at working load. Rather than using single factors like in working stress or ultimate load method, in this method we will use multiple safety factors. We use these multiple safety factors for adequate safety and serviceability by considering the limit state. So here we come to two new terms: what is limit state and what are multiple safety factors. Let's take a look on both of them. First is limit state. Limit state is acceptable limit for safety and serviceability requirement before failure occurs. It simply means we have to define some fixed limit on materials and load for safety and serviceability before the failure of structure. If a structure goes beyond the limit state, It either collapses or becomes unserviceable. There are two types of limit state. Limit state of collapse or failure, which deal with flexural, compression, shear and torsion. And another limit state is limit state of serviceability. And it deals with deflection, cracking, vibration, fire resistance, etc. So when we design any structure, we have to design according to the limit state. Now let's understand the concept of multiple safety factors. I have already told you that we use multiple safety factors for adequate safety and serviceability by considering the limit state. The value of multiple safety factor is based on experience, tradition, and engineering judgment. To show multiple safety factors, there are two main formats. One is load resistance factor design format, also known as LRFD format. Another one is partial safety factor. LRFD mostly used in America and other countries. In India, we use partial safety factor. So what is the concept of partial safety factor? IS code says that design resistance RD should be greater than or equal to design load effect SD. Design resistance simply resists or reduces the material strength, like in working stress method, with a suitable partial safety factor. The main difference in working stress and limit state method is that in working stress, we consider material as only linear, but in limit state, materials go beyond the elasticity and consider plastic behavior of material. We use symbol like gamma C and gamma S to represent the value of partial safety factor for concrete and steel. On the other hand, to consider the design load effect, we multiply or say enhance the load using partial safety factor. And symbolic representation for these values is gamma D for dead load, gamma L for live load, gamma W for wind or earthquake load. Here I hope you have understood the concept of limit state design. Now move to next section, some recommendations from IS-456 for limit state design. Characteristic strength and load. Characteristic strength for concrete is compressive strength of concrete cube specimen of 150 mm dimension. In the last lecture, I have explained you about characteristic strength. And we know that characteristic strength is defined as strength of material below which not more than 5% result are expected to fall. So let me illustrate you this concept with an example. Suppose we have 20 cube specimen of concrete. If we conduct compression test on concrete cube in laboratory, then not more than 1 out of 20 test result fall below the characteristic value. If we conduct 100 tests, then not more than 5 out of 100 test results should fall below the characteristic value. So suppose we have conducted the test on 20 specimens and the results are 27.3, 25.4, 26.9, 25.1 and so on, the 20 results. What we have to do next is arrange all of them in increasing order. There is a value which is less than 25 and rest of them are greater than 25. So you see here, out of 20, one test result falls below the 25. Hence, grade of concrete is M25 and characteristic strength of concrete is 25 MPa. And characteristic strength of steel is yield strength of steel. In the first lecture, I have explained you that specified yield strength may be treated as characteristic strength. If in any question, it is given that you have to use Fe500 steel. It means yield strength of steel is 500 MPa. And characteristic load. Characteristic load is the load which has 95% probability of not being exceeded during the lifetime of a structure. The load we estimate at the time of designing, we expect with a 95% probability that it does not exceed the estimated value. Hence, we call it characteristic load. Now, the value of partial safety factors according to IS code. I have already told you that there are two types of partial safety factors. One we use to restrict or reduce the material's strength, and another one is to enhance the load. And we also have two limit states, the limit state of collapse and limit state of serviceability. The partial safety factor for concrete is 1.5 and for steel is 1.15. And for limit state of serviceability, partial safety factors for both of the material is 1. And for combination of load, if dead and live load are acting together, then to get ultimate load, the partial safety factor is 1.5. If dead load is acting with wind load or earthquake load, then factor we can use either 1.5 for both of them or 0.9 for dead load and 1.5 for wind load. If all of them are acting together, then we use 1.2 as a partial safety factor for limit state of collapse. For limit state of serviceability, to get serviceable load, the partial safety factor for dead load and live load is 1, and for dead and wind load is also 1. If all the loads are acting together, 1 for dead load, 0.8 for live load, and 0.8 for earthquake load. We use partial safety factors of materials to get design strength, and we use partial safety factors of load to get factored load. A very important point that I would like to discuss here, we know that if we have a concrete cube of grade suppose M30, the characteristic strength of concrete will be 30 MPa, but we cannot use this value in design problem for full structure. Here we use 0.67 FCK rather than FCK. This value decreases due to influence of size. Compressive strength decreases as size increases. So the actual value of characteristic strength for structure is 0.67 FCK. Now how do we use the partial safety factor to get design strength? To get design strength of concrete, we divide the characteristic strength of structure 0.67 FCK with partial safety factor gamma C. The value of gamma C is 1.5 for concrete. The final value 0.45 FCK is called design strength of concrete. And for design strength of steel, we know that yield strength is the characteristic strength for steel. If we divide it with partial safety factors gamma S, and the value of gamma is 1.15 for steel, and design strength will be 0.87 FY. So I hope you have understood the concept of partial safety factor clearly. Now let us move to design stress strain curve of concrete. This is the characteristic curve of concrete cube specimen. This curve insists parabola in initial region up to a strain of 0.002. And from here slope becomes 0 and it remains constant up to an ultimate strain of 0.0035. The second curve is the characteristic curve of concrete structure and it is restricted to 0.67 FCK. I have explained you earlier about this. It is due to influence of size. And this is the design curve for ultimate limit state design. We get this curve by dividing the structure strength with partial safety factor for concrete. And the value of this curve is 0.45 FCK. Now let's take a look at design stress strain curve of steel. First for mild steel. It is characteristic curve of steel and we already know that yield strength Fy is characteristic strength of steel. For mild steel, the yield strength is 250 MPa. We restrict the yield strength using partial safety factor gamma F. The value of gamma is 1.15 for steel, hence value of design curve is 0.87 Fy. We can find out the corresponding design yield strain with the help of Hooke's law. Here, strain is design stress 0.87 Fy over modulus of elasticity of steel. And we know that for all types of steel, modulus of elasticity 2×10⁵ MPa. Now let's talk about HYSG bar. This is the characteristic curve of HYLD bar. You can find out the yield stress using 0.2% proof strain. Using same partial safety factors that we use in mild steel, we can draw the design curve for HYLD bar. Here, what will be the total corresponding strain developed in HYLD bar? First, we know that 0.2% is the proof strain. If you look at this curve, it behaves almost like mild steel curve. Hence, strain here will be similar to mild steel curve. Total strain here will be 0.002 plus 0.87 Fy over ES. This is the total strain and we will use it in upcoming design problem. So here we have finished all the section of this lecture. Now let's summarize what we have covered in this lecture. In this second lecture, initially we learned about loads like dead load, live load and environmental load. Most of the part of this lecture was on design philosophy, where I explained you that in design philosophy we learn about process of selecting materials and proportioning the elements like beam and column. We use two main factors for philosophy, the assumption and procedure for design. Then the working stress method. Here we assume material in elastic range and using factor of safety we get allowable stress. Another important concept in working stress method is modular ratio, which is ratio of two moduli of elasticity. After that, ultimate load, or we can say load factor method. Here we get ultimate load by enhancing the working load by load factor. Most of the part of the design philosophy was on limit state method. The main concept of limit state method is to consider safety at ultimate load and serviceability at working load. Here we learn about two types of limit state, the limit state of collapse and limit state of serviceability. Then concept of partial safety factor. This concept says that design resistance should be greater than or equal to design load effect. Then at last, some recommendation from IS456, like characteristic strength. In case of concrete, it is compressive strength of cube specimen, and in case of steel, it is yield strength of steel. The characteristic load is the load which has 95% probability of not being exceeded during the lifetime of structure. Then value of partial safety factor for limit state of collapse and limit state of serviceability for materials and loads separately. We use these factors to find out the design strength of material and factored load. An important point here is that we use 0.67 FCK as a characteristic strength for structure rather than simple FCK, because FCK is characteristic strength of cube. And then we learn about stress strain curve of concrete and steel. We will use this design value in design and analysis problem, and finally the curve of mild steel and HYLD bar. So I hope you have enjoyed this lecture. In this lecture, we cover a lot of basic concepts which will be very helpful in the upcoming lecture.